that pragmatism has been rewarded in years gone by when it comes to the coalition's approach. It might get messy at times, but that's the nature of this issue, isn't it?
Yeah, I think the government will reach a deal with the National Party. I think the government will do net zero by 2050, and as you've been reporting, a higher projection for 2030, but not a target. That seems the likely outcome. And I think it's got to the point where the Prime Minister has to land net zero by 2050, doesn't it? It would just look ridiculous at this point if he didn't make that work. He couldn't go to Glasgow without it. He's going to struggle at Glasgow anyway with such a weak and late commitment to net zero by 2050, and that no real increase in the 2030 ambition where all the focus is. I think, though, it's probably important to look at the detail. The two really interesting interventions, I thought, this week were Keith Pitt, who proposed one of the most economically reckless policies I've ever seen from a minister in a government, where he suggested $250 billion to underwrite industries that the world is moving away from and would leave massive stranded assets. But perhaps more importantly, from Angus Taylor, who said on the front page of the Financial Review that offsets will help coal and gas survive. And I think that's the really interesting thing to look for in this deal that's coming is, yes, net zero by 2050, but what does it mean? And if it's going to mean a whole lot of offsets that help coal and gas survive, as under Angus Taylor's words, is not really going to do the job. And net zero by 2050 will, in essence, be a fraud while it's propping up coal and gas. Now, no one says they have to end overnight, but the idea that we would be shoveling more money into support coal and gas while the rest of the world tries to get off it would make the Prime Minister's net zero by 2050 a fraud.